we sent out the report to citizens in the fall. So when we were having our internal discussions, you know, my understanding was it was a spring newsletter, and we ultimately came back to this insertion to come to the council for discussion. So if you were expecting something sooner, then I misunderstood that, because I was trying to separate the two reports. I thought you wanted to have a report that came out in the fall, the report to citizens, but then you wanted something in the spring. You wanted another separate mailing, and I certainly understood Councilmember Dare in particular wanted that hard copy, wanted that, you know, wanted that mailing. And so then we began discussing where the actual costs were. But my focus had always been the spring. So I apologize if you're disappointed that it hadn't been completed.
Didn't that, when the publication that was combined with the calendar, doesn't that come out in the spring?
It comes out in the spring, yes.
So you thought we were going to put two pieces out in the spring?
Separate from the calendar. Yes, we were going to do the calendar and then another report to citizens. I called it like a state of the city, and that's when Jessica and Jenny and I that met, and Jessica said, well, that's a great idea, but we can do that as an insert and put it in the report that goes out in the fall. So
I agree with you. I'm a communications person. So for me, having something in someone's hand is invaluable. I think, having done the newsletter, I know that one of my concerns is finding enough information to put in it biannually, and sometimes almost creating a little bit of fluff that goes in it to feel safe. So I think that the idea behind doing the four panel would also be to not have any fluff and have the real information that's in the hands in the fall, and again going along with the finance department and collaborating with them, because they do include a lot of, you know, they do include a few articles of information on community news in their update too. So again, trying to find a compromise between being fiscally responsible and certainly putting that document in their hands.
Well, my previous experience was we had too much information, had to cut it back in order to keep it a little bit more concise. But there's things for our community rating that, you know, where we get points. Well, one of the points we get is by having every year, call it fluff if you will, but what to do in case of a hurricane. Mm-hmm. Well, you get points for that. Mm-hmm. You don't want to run that in the fall when hurricane season's over. You want to run that in the spring. So I mean, there's a lot of messages to get out, and some of it is you repeat, like the bus schedule. You know, you can't put that out in the spring what your next winter's bus schedule is going to be, but you can do that in the fall. You know, there's timely messages to be had, I think, twice a year.
Jessica, what percent of, I know what we get in the spring, this four-page panel, what percent of the information, is it half, is it three-quarters of what we get out in the spring that we'll be able to disseminate? Because I know I don't really know what a four-page panel is.
Well, this is 12 pages.
Yeah.
11 by
That's 17. 4 pages?
This is 12.
12.
I'm sorry, so it might be 6.
So it's like a third then.
What I got the bids from when I was speaking to the different printing companies would be one 11 by 17, and it's folded, so it becomes four panels. So you essentially have four pages, one, mm-hmm. two, three, four. And that would be folded and ideally inserted into the report to citizens.
Versus the 6 pages.
Versus doing a complete separate publication.
Yeah, doesn't that sound the same? Doesn't that answer your concerns?
Well, we bought it. I understood Councilmember Dare's suggestion to want a separate mailing. Internally, we came up with this discussion with the council. So again, there's still a question of timing. So
we can certainly move back to doing it biannually. It's something that's not in the budget for 2014 at this time, but can be added.
And again, what's the extra cost for biannually?
It was approximately $31,565. So you're looking at roughly $16,000 each time, with the postage taking up about $10,000 of that.
So we're essentially going to have three mailings then. If we don't use the report to citizens as an opportunity for the insert, we're going to have three mailings to the public. We'll have the fall report, we'll have the spring report, and then the calendar with additional information.
I just seems like a good compromise to me.
Councilmember Dare.
I don't mind it being two mailings. Not at all. But, you know, the idea that's going to be condensed into four small pages in the 11 font as a drop-in, you know, I want to get past that. You know, if the spring is a newsletter and the calendar, that's fine. And if the fall is the report to citizens on the financial report and a newsletter, that's fine. But it should be something that's inviting so that people actually sit down, look at it, read it. And the fall, if it's a fiscal report on the past fiscal year, fine. But then a newsletter, you know, maybe an update for the winter calendar that actually has information that wasn't available the previous March.
What's she saying?
Did you explore the cost if it was the same size and just mailing it in the same envelope, the report to the fiscal report and then an additional newsletter? Would that be less expensive?
Well, when we explored the cost, like I said, let me see if I can pull that up.
I see what Councilmember Dare is saying. When you get something small, it doesn't have the importance that originally came out in the spring.
Oh, thank you. I did have it here. We did explore, you know, when I got bids, I asked for a couple different suggestions. The one with the four panel to print 35,000 was $3,393. And she did give me several different options. So again, you know, I think when I spoke with the budget manager, what was brought up in the meeting was using roughly $3,000. So I was trying to stay within that number that was given to me, or at least what I was thinking. So we did explore doing a couple different sized, and the, obviously the larger you go with an update, the cost will go higher. For example, a six-page trifold brochure, you're looking at closer to $4,500 just to print. So I did get a couple different. It's just a matter of what we have in the budget and what we put in, what you decide as the mayor and council you want to see for citizens.
I appreciate what the communications manager is saying. I am more interested in hearing today what your expectations are as opposed to whether it costs $4,500 or $3,000. Right. I'd like to leave here today with an understanding of what you expect and when you expect it, and we'll get it done. Just as we said in April, we'll find the money to do two mailings if that's what your expectations are. I'm not worried about $1,500. If you want a better publication rather than the four pages, if you want more newspaper style, and that costs $1,500 more, we will do that. It's what you want us to do. That's all we need to hear.
Councilmember Pillis.
Yeah, that's what I have my light on for saying, why can't the financial letter and all the extras that we want to put on the calendar, whatever it is we want to put in, why can't it be done in the newspaper style? It certainly would be less expensive than an additional mailing, and yet it would be more inviting to read something all about the town. I mean, when I get something, I really don't like an insert. I like it all one. I wouldn't mind going through it and saying this is a financial, and, you know, I'd like to have all of it in one piece of paper. One issue.
I did speak with our financial administrator, and I think that we could collaborate in bringing it together. I mean, they have done a really wonderful job at doing it out of their office. So I would be happy to collaborate with them in any way to make it, you know, I think, you know, to make it, again, whatever you decide, we will make happen.
Well, I'll ask for the motion to be changed and maybe adjust it. Would you consider that, Brent?
Well, my motion originally was for Jessica to work with the finance and come up with the best solution.
Oh, no, I think you put in the 4-page insert, yeah. I
said 11x17.
Right.
But I think.
So will you adjust it to the wording, change the wording to say create.
To work out the best arrangement.
One policy, yeah. One issue, one,
yeah, one
document.
Whatever works out the best.
Right.
Yeah, I'll adjust my motion.
Is that what you're looking for, Dennis? The information to be fully put into a more, you know, publication style paper where somebody would enjoy reading it?
Yes, but question when?
Oh.
Okay, Councilmember Dare, I think.
Why don't you?
Yes, Ms. Waters, when would, because right now, Dennis, I would suspect you're looking at the spring and the fall.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Right. Here's what I think that we can do. First, let me make sure that I understand what the motion attempts to accomplish. We are going to combine, instead of the Jessica, the report to citizens, instead of the traditional report to citizens that is how many ever pages but folded in half, we are going, which has already been mailed for the fall. Next year, we are going to incorporate that information and more into a newspaper style publication, hold up the newspaper publication, the big one, that kind of publication next fall. To address Dennis's question, when we will develop that same style, hold it up, newspaper publication, for the spring, and fill it with additional information in addition to the calendar. I think that's what you want.
Well,
Councilmember Dare.
Yeah. Yes, that would be fine, because what we had was a newsletter in the spring and a financial report in the fall. And my expectations when I brought this up during the budget last spring was to do the newsletter in the fall. 7 months later, that hadn't happened. Fall's over. Feels like winter out there today.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't have any expectations anymore of having a fall newsletter.
Right. You can get an insert this year, okay, if you like.
No, the insert's gone because the report to citizens has been mailed.
Right.
So I don't know if we need a motion because, you know, what we're talking about is going to be done, has been budgeted for the spring. Right. And any additional funding that I was willing to make a motion for last spring will be done during the budget process this year.
But we did save a little money on something we bid on today, we acknowledged today. So maybe there is a little money there.
Yeah.
But it's too late.
It's too late.
November 25th or
let me say this. The expectations were not clear then because it was certainly not on my radar to have the newsletter in the fall. It was to have it done in a second newsletter to be done in the spring. So it was always a second newsletter, and the internal discussion was how do we accomplish it? So.
Mr. Mayor.
Well, since I'm the guilty party here, because I'm the one that took the second newsletter letter out of the budget during the interim between Mr. Dare and Mr. Recor. And again, it was as a cost-saving measure in order to bring in a balanced budget. And as you both know, with all budgets, there are things that you don't want to take out that you end up taking out in order to meet the test. And that's what was done. Subsequent to that, Councilman Dare, did bring up last spring during the budget discussions to add it, and we said that we would look at a way to do that. Unfortunately, he's correct. Trying to meet the test, we've missed the deadline. And you're right. The next one that comes out will be the spring newsletter, which will be a complete newsletter. And the best action we could probably take today to try to make it at least so that it happens correctly next year is that as you prepare the budget, which you're in the process of beginning to put together, that we ask you to include in the budget now both for the next fiscal year a spring newsletter and a fall combined newsletter and financial report.
Right.
So if we did that, at least we'd be covered moving forward. So I would recommend you make that motion so at least that gets in the works, and that'll be what will be presented to us and included in their preliminary budget.
And that's what I asked Ashley to do, is to incorporate it for next year.
Councilmember Ashley, will you rescind the first motion?
Yes.
And Councilmember Pillows, you'll rescind the first
motion. Can we just change the wording?
Let's go with my motion.
Let's just rescind it. And then now we have, okay. Do I have a new motion on the floor from somebody?
Dennis, I'll let you do that one.
Councilmember Dare.
I'd like to make the motion as the mayor stated. So.
And
so we move forward with the spring newsletter and the fall combined newsletter and financial report in next fiscal year's budget.
Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, I have a motion on the floor by Councilmember Dare with a second by Councilmember Pillows that we move forward with the mayor's recommendation to have a spring newsletter and then to include in our fiscal budget 2016, a fall newsletter that will be combined with a report to the citizens.
It'll be one letter, too, one issue.
To be not combined.
Right.
Combined.
Do I have a vote? All those in favor?
I'm voting.
We have 6 in favor. The vote is unanimous with Councilmember Martin on vacation. Yes, sir.
I apologize, Mr. Dare.
For what? No, one last comment. Some of the discussion last spring, as I recall, had to do with the postage and mailing it out and going to send it out electronically. But that's something that people are going to have to opt in. So just a reminder, as you draft the spring newsletter, to put something in there asking people if you'd like to receive this electronically, we need your email address.
And we'll make it available online anyway. PDF it, put it on the website. And
but maybe we can start to develop a list so that we can reduce the postage in the future by sending it out electronically to those who opt in.
Create a mailing group or mailing list.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Ms. Waters, you're still up, and we're going to discuss now the social media policy.
Yes, well, speaking about how important communications is, how we communicate today is much different than how we communicated 5 years ago. Social media has changed the way that we communicate in our personal and professional lives. So when I took this position, I started looking at some of our social media accounts that we have here in the city and looking at any type of policy that we had that regulated them and realized that there wasn't any. So there's no expectation of how we as a town expect our social media accounts to be operating. So after doing a lot of researching and talking to a lot of different municipalities and private companies, I've worked closely with our human resources director. And we also consulted with Miles Stockbridge in a policy that would set some expectations for employees who will be operating our social media accounts. Because currently there's no policy that says that an employee in Public Works can start their own official Public Works Facebook page or any type of Facebook page that acts as an official Ocean City site. So I wanted there to be something that held the people who are maintaining these sites and managing these sites, some expectations and what's expected of them in an official capacity.
Question.
Councilmember Pillis.
Question. Do we have people actually on Facebook in our town, our staff?
We do.
That's out there on social media talking about this town in what way?
In an official way.
Oh.
We have a lot of official, and actually the feedback that we get from our Facebook and our Twitter and our YouTube accounts is marvelous. It's really a wonderful way to promote the town of Ocean City. And right now we have a really wonderful group of people who are managing those sites, and without having had any formal expectations, they've kind of taken it on as an additional duty to make sure that they're updating them and maintaining them. Moving forward, I would like to make sure that we do have something in place.
Okay, but just to answer my question, how many departments do this?
We have multiple. I did compile a list in the appendix on the last page of the policy that went over just a few of the, at least my understanding of all the accounts that we have. So Facebook, we have a Town of Ocean City account, a tourism account, a police department account, a fire department account. There's a volunteer fire department account, a beach patrol account, a special events account, a convention center account, a recreation and parks account, and a life saving station account.
Does all this go through you before they do anything on these accounts?
It has not, although this policy does recommend that all goes through the communications manager.
Okay.
That's why we're bringing it
forward. Okay. But do we not, this is off the subject, and I'll make a motion for that, by the way. I'll make a motion with the questions going this way, that we go ahead and accept the social media policy that's been presented by the communications manager. We're going to get to see this policy before? You're just going to move forward, and we're going to be able to discuss this in public, though.
It's in your packet.
I know, but are you going to read it into the record in some way?
Oh, I wasn't planning on it.
Okay. Let me ask a question, though, another question. Do we not have a department policy or a town policy that every employee doesn't run a Facebook account or any twiddling or anything like that out here in the public?
We do have policies.
They're not supposed to be doing that.
Right, that are included in the employee handbook and an IT policy that restricts personal use. This policy pertains to more of official, yes, Facebook use, so yes, there are those policies.
Maybe we ought to have a discussion about personal use. Is that enforced?
That's coming subsequent. We thought we would start with with the town sponsored, the official town sites, and then come
this
in.
This is the first I've heard of it, so that's why I'm asking these questions.
Yeah, and it's a really good question, actually. And actually, next week, we'll be hosting a training seminar with the state of Maryland's going to come down, and we're going to do best practices. We've asked all of our employees to attend.
Okay.
It's not a mandatory class, but I've worked closely with the human resource director, and for future employees, we're going to have it be part of their orientation. And it's really a best practices as to how to behave, do the do's and don'ts of social media etiquette in your personal. There's quite a bit of, and I'm sure Guy could weigh in on what you can and can't regulate on someone's personal Facebook pages. So again, in all my research, in talking to multiple other departments and towns and municipalities and businesses that have these policies, it was recommended that a policy for official sites is the way to go. However, when you're talking about the personal use, is to try to educate and empower people to make good decisions in the social world.
Yeah.
And of course, one of the main parts of that is to keep your behavior in a social world the same as you do out of the social world, which is included in the employee handbook, and following all of those rules in and out of social media.
All right. So I made my motion for you.
Okay, we have a motion by Councilmember Pillis to accept the social media policy. Are you going to do it for the second? Because then I have Joe.
Okay. Oh, yeah, we got a second.
Okay. Councilmember Matresik, I know you're on.
I was actually on to make the motion or a second.
Okay, so we have a second by Councilmember Matresik. Are there any other comments on this? I had a couple questions, if I could. Where I read about post appearing, do we reserve the right, like, for example, if an employee does have the authority to make a post, you review that post before it appears?
I don't review. I do review many of them. They do have the option to post on their own, as long as they're
following
posting in an official.
Following the rules, right.
Right, exactly. As long as they're, and again, I just wanted to make sure that we do in the future moving forward, because right now we have really wonderful people maintaining our social media sites, so I'm very fortunate. But in the policy, it does ask that the communications manager be able to see over those posts. And I will say, many of the staff now, when they get a post that they aren't sure how to respond, do call me. And I do appreciate that teamwork. So they do say, you know, how do you think that we should respond on any type of sticky post that they might see? And we have had to remove posts, and we do archive all of our posts and make sure that, you know, we're following all of the state and federal laws in regard to public information. So, yes, I will oversee it. However, the department head has allowed that person to speak on behalf of, so they are allowed to do it without my, I guess, overseeing, although I do monitor it.
No, and I think that's a good idea. My second question is, if you get somebody, you know, out in the public that posts something on the police department and they use ugly words, we have every right not to allow that post to even be seen.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And
so
we we'll comment that it's been removed, and we will all archive it first. And we do have a disclaimer that I wrote into the policy that will say what, you know, some of the things that will warrant a removal of a post. Anything off topic, anything profane, anything that is offensive.
I just wanted to make sure that the listening office, the listening group, understands that this is really a policy for us, the town of Ocean City, that we cannot, you know, have a policy for, you know, somebody out there who wants to comment on a page, but we do have the right to remove it if it's not pertinent or uses foul language or just inappropriate.
And that's the great thing about social media, is that people can comment on our pages, and it allows us to be very interactive with our audience, which I love. Unfortunately, every now and again, you do get one of those posts that are offensive and inappropriate. So this policy just allows us to remove those types of posts.
Great. Thank you. I have a motion by Councilmember Pillis and a second by Councilmember Matresic to accept to approve the social media policy presented today. All those in favor? It's a unanimous vote with Councilmember Martin out of the office. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good job, Jessica.
Our next item, you're not on, Councilmember Ashley,
no,
are you?
No,
okay.
No, ma'am.
Our next item is the request to approve the veterans hiring policy presented by Wayne Evans, who is our human resource director. Mr. Evans.
Thank you, and good afternoon. I'm here as a follow-up to the November 12th work session, where you had an opportunity to review a discussion draft on veterans hiring policy elements, and at your as you voted at your request, I've come back to you with a formal policy that incorporates the elements that you discussed and approved at that meeting. So the formal policy is presented for your approval. So one pager, I'll be happy to read it if you'd like it read into the record. Or
yeah, I'd like you to read it into record.
Sure. In recognition of their sacrifice and commitment in defense of our nation, the town of Ocean City adopts this veterans hiring policy to provide employment opportunities to men and women who have served in the United States Armed Forces. Definitions. Veteran is any person who served in the Armed Forces of the United States and was discharged or released from active duty under honorable conditions. The spouse of a disabled veteran is eligible for consideration under this policy. Documentation. Veterans, disabled veterans, and spouses of disabled veterans shall furnish document DD-214, military discharge papers, or equivalent certification, and spouses shall furnish evidence of veterans' disability and marriage to the veteran at the time of the employment application. Policy. Element A, the town will expand its outreach to veterans by posting employment opportunity notices on career websites that are specific to veterans. B, fully qualified applicants with documented veteran status will be offered a preliminary interview. C, most qualified applicants will be determined based on criteria established for each position prior to the search. The criteria may include successful completion of interviews, satisfactory work history and references, or other demonstrations from which candidate responses are solicited and considered. If a veteran is in the most qualified applicant pool, the position will be filled by a veteran. D, veteran status will be tracked and evaluated for each recruitment process. E, this is a hiring policy and is not applied in the case of promotion, nor does this policy guarantee employment for any applicant, regardless of status.
Councilmember Matrasik.
Motion to approve the Veterans Hiring Policy 300-17.
Councilmember Pillish.
I'll second it, and I have a question.
Go ahead.
Number B, letter B, I think it was, where it's they will have a preliminary opportunity to have a preliminary. So if I apply for the job and or another person applies for the job that's not a veteran, the veteran gets the preliminary?
Is that you may get a preliminary interview as well, but if you're a veteran, we're going to make sure that you interview for the position.
Okay. I have a motion to approve the Veterans Hiring Policy 300-17 by Councilmember Matrasik, with a second by Councilmember Pillis. All in favor? Let the record reflect that it was a unanimous vote with Councilmember Martin absent.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Wayne.
Councilmember Matrasik.
Motion to adjourn.
Councilmember Pillis.
I'll second.
I have a motion to adjourn the meeting by Councilmember Matrasik and a second by Councilmember Pillis. All in favor? Let the record reflect the vote was unanimous with Councilmember Martin absent.
Nice job, Council Secretary.
Thank you.